In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. By the word of the Lord, the heavens were made, their starry hosts by the breath of his mouth. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. For in him the whole fullness of deity dwells bodily, and in Christ you have been brought to fullness. He is the head over every power and authority. No one has ever seen God, but the one and only Son, who is in himself God and is in closest relationship with the Father, has made him known. The Father and I are one. The heavens declare the glory of God. The skies proclaim the work of his hands. For in him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible. Whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities, all things have been created through him and for him. For since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities, his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly seen, being understood from what has been made, so that people are without excuse.
Your hidden glory in creation.
Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Long ago, at many times and in many ways, God spoke to our fathers by the prophets. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed the heir of all things, through whom also he created the world. All things have been delivered to me by my Father, and no one knows the Son except the Father, nor does anyone know the Father except the Son, and the one whom the Son wills to reveal him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Whatever you ask in my name, this I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. And there is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved.
What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. The name. Beautiful name it is, the name.
Worship is probably one of my absolute favorite nights of the year when we get to do this. I mean, probably all week I have looked forward to this night, and it's kind of a cool night too, because not only is it night of worship for our church, but for college students, this is their proximity service, and I love that service too, and so it's like the two have combined and made one mega night of worship, which is amazing. But one of the things coming into tonight that I was kind of thinking through is, like, why do we do this? What's the purpose for us getting together on a Friday night and worshiping together? And the truth is, there are a lot of purposes. There's a lot of good reasons that we do this. But one of the ones that kind of stood out to me was that on a Friday night, we could be doing a lot of other things. And the reality is, you have worked all week, and so probably you're a little tired, and it would have been really easy to say, I just need to rest. I need something to do. I could lay here and watch Netflix for 5.5 hours. I could take a nap. I could go to dinner, come home, watch sports for a little while, and call it a night. And that's what the world has convinced us a lot of times that rest is. But I think one of the reasons that we come to things like this is because listen to how Jesus defines rest. This is Matthew 11, 28 through 30. And it says, "Then Jesus said, 'Come to me, all of you who are weary and carry heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you. Let me teach you, because I am humble and gentle at heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy to bear, and the burden that I give you is light.'" doing the absolute best type of rest that we can. More restful than sitting down and watching Netflix for 4 hours. More restful than taking a nap. We're coming to the Creator who wants time with us and tells us, hey, if you'll just come to me, I can give you rest. And so tonight we gather, and even though we're singing and up on our feet and excited, this is the way that God designed for us to fill up and rest. So let me encourage you to enjoy tonight, to find rest for your soul tonight, to sing with everything you got, because God is deserving of it and worthy of it. And we're going to talk more about that tonight. But we're about to sing a song called Awake My Soul. And so we're going to focus on this idea that it's really easy for us to just kind of sleepwalk through a week, maybe check a couple boxes for quiet times, and it's really easy for us to just move to the next week. It's just a normal Friday night. And in this song, we remind ourselves, we're actually singing to ourselves, which is pretty unique. It's not what we do in every worship song, but in this one, we kind of sing to ourselves and say, hey, soul, wake up. God's good. He deserves your songs. He deserves your praise. And so let's sing this together.
Pray where we hear praises here.
just a second. And I want to tell you about something that we do every Sunday morning as a worship team, and then I want y'all to take part in it with us right here. So one thing that we do every single Sunday is when we first get here, before rehearsal ever starts, before we ever start tuning guitars and trying to make sure that harmonies line up and all the rehearsal things, we take a little bit of time, and Dan, our bass player, gives us scripture that we read through and then pray through. And that's how we start the morning. And a lot of times the scripture that he gives us will have something to do with the songs that we're going to sing that day so that we can go ahead and prepare our hearts for worship. And so I want y'all to take part of that with us. And so if you've got your Bible with you, or if you've just got your phone and you can pull up the trusty Bible app, turn to Isaiah 53 and look at verses 4 through 6. And I'll give you a second to get there, but the next song that we're about to sing comes from this scripture. And it says this: "Yet it was in our weakness he carried. It was our sorrows that weighed him down, and we thought his troubles were punishment from God, a punishment for his own sins. But he was pierced for our rebellion. He was crushed for our sins. He was beaten so we could be whole. And he was whipped so we could be healed. All of us, like sheep, have strayed away. We have left God's paths to follow our own. Yet the Lord laid on him the sins of us all." So we're about to sing this song called "It Is So." And when we get to the chorus of the song, we say, "By his stripes, we are healed." We're made whole by Jesus. And it comes from this scripture. And so what I want us to do for just a minute is take a second and read through that and pray through the verse. If you ever struggle praying and you think, "Well, I don't really know what to pray about when I pray," start with scripture and take a verse and start praying through it and say, "Jesus, thank you that your stripes were for me, and that I don't deserve the salvation that I got, but you died in my place for my rebellion, and it's by you that I'm made whole." And take a second and pray through that verse and understand where this song's coming from. And then when you're ready to stand back up and sing with us, stand back up, and then you'll know where the lyrics that we sing come from. That's why we started Night of Worship the way that we did, is that the songs that we sing, they're great, and the lyrics are powerful, but they're powerful because of where they come from. Not just because it's good songs and good music and they're fun to sing, but they're powerful because the songs we sing just tell the story of who God is and what he's done, and the songs are pulled from scripture. And so the song we're about to sing talks about the stripes of Jesus, the wounds of Jesus being inflicted because of our sin, and that we're made whole and we're healed because of him. He uses the word healed, past tense. So it's not that Jesus is trying to heal you, but Jesus has healed you if you claim faith in him. And so take a second, pray through those verses, and then we're going to come back and sing together, and you can stand back up when you're ready. it demands response from us. And so tonight, the passage that we're talking about that Ryan's about to come speak on comes out of 1 Peter. And basically, the first part of the passage that we're not covering tonight is where he talks about how good God is and that he's our hope. He's our living hope. In staff meeting, we were talking about that this week, and I like something that Pastor Kevin said. He said the word hope, even though it's correctly translated there, it's almost better said assurance. It's not that we just have hope that maybe Jesus will come through on what he said he'll come through on, but we have the assurance that Jesus will do what he said he'll do. And then what we're talking about tonight, at night of worship, is that when we believe that to be true about Jesus, then it changes the way that we obey. It changes our hearts. It changes the things that we do. God tells us to be holy because he is holy. And so here's what we're talking about tonight. Let me read this to y'all. Y'all can take a seat. This is 1 Peter 1:13-21. It says this. So think clearly and exercise self-control. Look forward to the gracious salvation that will come to you when Jesus Christ is revealed to the world. So you must live as God's obedient children. Don't slip back into the old ways of living to satisfy your own desires. You didn't know any better then. But now you must be holy in everything you do, just as God, who is holy, chose you to be holy. For the scriptures say, you must be holy because I am holy. And remember that the Heavenly Father, to whom you pray, has no favorites. He will judge or reward you according to what you do, so you must live in reverent fear of him during your times as foreigners in the land. For you know that God has paid a ransom to save you from the empty life you inherited from your ancestors. And the ransom he paid was not mere gold or silver, but it was the precious blood of Christ, the sinless, spotless Lamb of God. God chose him as your ransom long before the world began, but he has now revealed him to you in these last days. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, we're thankful for tonight. God, we're thankful for your goodness. God, we're thankful for the price that you've paid for us, that it was by your stripes that we're healed. It's in you that we're made whole. And so, God, if we believe that to be true tonight, and if we trust that, then it demands response on our part. You can't just be our Savior, but not also get to be our King. And so, God, we pray that we would submit to who you are tonight, that as we look at your goodness, our desire is holiness, because you are holy. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Man, what a joy it is to gather among fellow believers, fellow brothers and sisters in Christ, and sing praises to our King. It is truly encouraging. And for those of you who I don't know, my name is Ryan, and I serve as college pastor here at Northway. And I'm really excited to be here tonight, but to also be here to study God's Word with you and worship in that way as well. So several years back when I was in college, my buddy Micah and I went to this college conference in Atlanta, and it was this massive conference in the Georgia Dome. There were about 60,000 college students at this place, and the way it would work is you would go to a session, and then after the sessions that night, you would go to these different smaller but still large groups broken down from the sessions. And so Micah and I were in the nosebleeds that night, and after our session ended, we were headed to our breakout group with thousands of other college students, making our way down, you know, the ramps that they have in stadiums, and it's going pretty smoothly, getting to our location. We get to the end of our rope, about to exit out of the Georgia Dome to our group, and we had a realization that we were in the wrong place. That we were supposed to actually be on the complete other end of the Georgia Dome. And we were like, oh no. And what we realized as well is that we couldn't just exit out and go around because they'd blocked it off. That what we then had to do was to work our way back against the thousands and thousands of college students who were pouring out of this exit to get all the way to the other end of the Georgia Dome. And so we started our trek back. We are going up these ramps, and this is pre-pandemic, so this is no such thing as distancing. There are like thousands of people just crammed in this little area. You could, so close, you could smell people's breath. And you're pushing it back against these ramps. We're like on the rail trying to make ourselves small, which me and Micah weren't that small. And so it was hard to push back. We were like pulling like we were rock climbing up these things, juking out people trying to get to where we were going. And after about 45 minutes to an hour, we finally got all the way across to where we were supposed to be in the first place. See, here's the deal. It was easy for us to get where we were going, just going with the flow of everyone else. It's easy to move with the flow of all those people. It was very, very difficult to turn around and push back against the flow of people, but it was very necessary. And here's why I tell you this. It is very easy to go with the flow of the world's standard. Go with the flow of everyone else in culture and what they say is good and true and what they say is fulfilling. It is very difficult to stand against it and stand for something else, but it's very necessary. And that's what I want to talk about tonight. The passage that Eric read was in 1 Peter chapter 1. So if you have your Bibles or Bible apps, you can get that out. We're not going to reread it, but that'll be where we'll be referencing from is 1 Peter chapter 1. And Peter's written by the Apostle Peter to who he says are the elect exiles. Elect meaning chosen, set apart by God, his Christian people, and exiles because they were Christians. You see, Christians don't belong here. Christians, this is a temporary home. Their home is elsewhere. They're only here for a moment. And so in a sense, they are exiles. They are sojourners. And for these particular Christians, they were undergoing some increasing persecution. It was getting more and more difficult to claim what they claimed, to believe what they believed, to identify as a Christian. And so Peter writes this letter to them. He writes this letter to encourage them. You see, it would have been very easy for them to fall into the temptation to look and, as they're facing these trials, to say, is it worth even persevering and enduring through these trials? Is it worth holding true to my Christian values and my Christian life to endure through these difficult times? Or maybe not, is it worth it? Maybe they felt worth it, but maybe they said, am I even going to have the strength to endure and to push through? It also would have been very easy for them to just put their head down and go with the flow of everyone else. To say, you know, I've got my personal relationship with God, but I'm going to just blend in with the culture so that I don't stick out and so I don't have to undergo this persecution. I'm going to indulge in whatever the world is indulging in, because if I don't, it would be weird. I'm going to not really, at least publicly, gather with my Christian friends and maybe not even gather at all with other Christians. I'm just going to do whatever it is that will make me fit in, and I'm going to do whatever it is that's with culture and with the flow of everyone else, so I don't stick out and have to undergo this persecution. And let's be honest, for us, in our culture, in our time, it is far easier to just fit in with the rest of the world, to just go with the flow of the culture, to indulge in what it is the world indulges in, to treat people how the world treats them. And in some ways, it's because we don't want to stick out socially. We don't want to undergo any kind of persecution, although our persecution is far different than theirs. But let's be honest, the big reason why it's easy is because there's a big part of us that likes it. The Bible tells us that we, mankind, loves the darkness. And the Bible didn't have to tell us that for us to know that. We enjoy indulging in the things that the world indulges in. We enjoy doing whatever it is that we want to do. But the problem is in the verses that Eric just read, is Peter called them as Christians to be holy, to be set apart from the rest of the world. Holy means set apart, other than, pure, righteous. He says, be holy because the Lord your God is holy. That is his character. That is his nature. He is holy. He is perfect. He is pure. He is perfectly loving, perfectly good, perfectly kind, perfectly just. That is his essence. That is who he is. And when he created all things, He created mankind special. He stamped his image on mankind. Mankind was meant to bear the image of God. That they, as their God is holy, was to be holy. To be set apart. To be pure and righteous. To perfectly love and be kind and just. God gave us as mankind certain standards and rules to live within, some boundaries to live within so that they could thrive under his holy standard. But you see, mankind rejected him. They rejected his rule and chose self-rule. They turned from God and turned to sin. And in doing this, they tarnished the image of God. That as they were created to be image bearers, they've now distorted God's image in them. That in doing so, what the Bible teaches is that mankind is dead in their sins and trespasses. That all of us have sinned against a holy and mighty God, and we are deserving of his wrath because we have separated ourselves from the author of life itself. That is the condition of every single person. And here's the thing. We can still see glimpses of God's holiness in people. We can still see glimpses of his image where mankind can be kind and loving and they can be just at times. But we also see the wickedness, right? We see mankind treat others poorly. We see them lie and cheat and steal and bring destruction and even kill. See, we're all fallen and incapable of being holy as the Lord our God is holy. And so that poses a problem here because Peter has called them to be holy. He says, hey, live holy for the Lord your God is holy. And so how can they do this? Well, in the first verses of 1 Peter, he tells them. He says, the Lord your God causes you to be born again. Born again through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. See, we're all broken and we're dead in our sins and trespasses. We are all by nature enemies of God. But God, rich in mercy and love, sends Jesus. Jesus walks this creation, lives the perfect life that we could not live, that perfect and holy standard. And then he goes to the cross to die a death, to pay the penalty for our sins. To be the perfect and holy, unblemished Lamb of God, the sacrifice for our sins. And then, though he died on that cross on the third day, God raised him in victory. He raised him with victory, and with that resurrection came a promise that if anyone would humble themselves before God, admitting their sins before him, admitting their brokenness, admitting their need of Jesus, a Savior, and they confess him as Lord of their lives, as King, as ruler, and they believe that God raised him from the dead, it says that they will have salvation. That as they humble themselves for the Lord, that something special happens. That their sins are placed on the cross of Christ. And that as God poured out his wrath on Jesus on the cross, his wrath destroys their sins. And then Jesus' righteousness, his perfection, his holiness is taken and placed on the person. So that when God looks down at this person, he doesn't see a sinner deserving of his wrath. He sees a son, a daughter. He sees the righteousness of Jesus, the perfection, the holiness of Jesus. And what Peter tells us in chapter 1 is that they are saved to a living hope, an inheritance. This inheritance is something that they received to where we walk in the presence of God. That the Christian, when they pass away, will walk in the presence of God forever in eternity in his kingdom. That is the rich inheritance that has been secured for the believer, for the follower of Jesus. And this gives the follower of Jesus a living hope, a hope that is new daily. And he says that, and what it teaches us in Scripture is that this inheritance is sealed, that the promise that we can see is through the Holy Spirit dwelling within the Christian. That as you put your faith and trust in Jesus and you're secured this inheritance, he sends the Holy Spirit, God himself, will then to dwell in the Christian. And this Holy Spirit takes you and shapes and molds the heart of the believer to look more and more like Jesus. so that the Christian then begins to portray the fruits of the Spirit, the love, the joy, the peace, the patience, to a supernatural extent. They begin to look more and more like Jesus until one day in eternity they'll be fully glorified, fully made to look like Jesus, fully holy, and dwell in his presence for all eternity. That's the hope of the Christian that Peter tells us. And with this hope, it comes an inheritance. He also tells them to remember their identity. He says that you live as obedient children of God. He says you live holy because of who you are as God's child. You see, children tend to look like their parents, right? Many of you have probably gotten where someone walks up to you and they say, hey, you look just like your mom when you did that. Or you sound just like your dad when you said that. It's because the tendency is that parents tend to look like their, or children tend to look like their parents. See, as children of God, with the Holy Spirit working in us, we will begin to look like our Heavenly Father. The image that we were meant to portray, his image, is being restored within us. So we will begin to take on the traits that he has because of whose we are, because of our identity as his child. But then he also says in those verses that Eric read that we've been ransomed. How do you live holy? You look and remember that you've been ransomed, that you were, what Paul says, enslaved to sin. You were captive of sin. And then Jesus died on the cross, and his blood served as the ransom to set you free from the chains of sin and death. You have been set free to live as an obedient child of God. See, here's the problem, though. So many people buy into the misconception that we've been set free to sin, that we've been set free to then go do whatever we want to do, right? Because we're forgiven and Jesus died to pay my sins, so I can live however I want to live. But that's not the case. We haven't been set free to sin. We've been set free from sin. Sin is not freedom. Doing whatever you want, whenever you want it, is being a slave to your desires. And what the Bible teaches is that sin is destructive. Sin brings death. It's fun for a moment. It might satisfy us for just a moment, but it will never satisfy the desires of our hearts. It brings destruction. It brings destruction in our lives. It brings destruction in our relationships, and ultimately it brings eternal destruction. And so Jesus died to set you free from that. Not so that you can return and go back to it. He set you free so that you can then live and pursue a life of holiness that God had intended to you. And within his standard of holiness is true life. It's life in abundance. It's not restricting and constraining. It's where you can thrive because that's how he intended for you to live. That's how he created and designed you to live. He says, be holy, for the Lord your God is holy. He says, we do this through fighting the battle of our mind. He says, you do this through thinking actively, thinking with action, preparing your minds for battle. It's not us passively letting our minds wander from thing to thing. It's saying, hey, set your mind on what's been done for you. Set your mind on Jesus. He says, be sober-minded, clear thinking. Don't let the circumstances of life or temptation distort your thinking. He says, with clarity, set your mind on what Jesus has done. And set, as you set your mind on what Jesus has done, let your heart follow. Let your desires and your hope be set on the grace of Jesus. And as your desires are set on the grace of Jesus, you will then walk in pursuit of holiness. Your conduct changes. See, we set our minds on what Jesus has done and the inheritance that was secured to us. And then our hearts are stirred. Our affections are stirred for God. And our hearts are set on what he has done. And as our hearts are set, our actions will follow. He says, don't go back to your old way of life. You've had this new life that has been secured for you through Jesus. Walk in freedom. Walk in freedom of obedience to your Heavenly Father. And when you do this, when you live a life in pursuit of holiness, you will be different from this world. That you will truly be an exile in this world. You will look different. You will think, speak, and act different. And people will notice. And there'll be some who will reject you for it. Jesus says, hey, if they hated me, of course they're going to hate you. So there'll be some that will reject you because of your claims of Christianity. They'll persecute you in some ways. They'll call you certain names. You will be rejected because you are different from the world around you. But by the grace of God, what Peter says later on in this letter, by the grace of God, through the power of the Holy Spirit, maybe some, when they see your conduct, will be won for the sake of Christ. That through the testimony of your life, the way you live, the way you speak, the way you interact with those around you. Peter talks about how they're dealing with difficulty with their authorities and with spouses and all these different things. And he says, hey, submit to them in love, and maybe by your conduct you will win them. Maybe through the power of your life being lived in pursuit of holiness, there will be some that will see the life that you're living, and that the Holy Spirit will grab hold of their hearts, and that their eternities will be changed because the Holy Spirit used you to work in their lives. Christian, live in pursuit of this holiness. Live in light of the precious blood of Jesus that ransomed you from the captivity of sin and death, and pursue holiness. Not to earn some sort of status, but because of your status as his child, live as his obedient children. Pursue the Lord. Be holy, because the Lord your God is holy. If you will bow with me in prayer, I want to give us a moment to reflect on studying his word, and reflect and spend time in prayer on in ways that he might speak to you in this time. For some of you, you are followers of Jesus. You are in pursuit of obedience. But here's the reality: we are not perfect. That even though we have the Holy Spirit dwelling within us, it is easy for us to slip back into our old sinful ways. It's easy for us to slip back and listen to our fleshly desires. And so my encouragement for you during this time, as we prepare to go back into worship, is to confess any sin that's in your life, to bring it before the Lord, knowing what's been done for you on the cross, knowing that you've been forgiven, that you would set your mind on the truth of the gospel, and that it would stir the affections of your heart, and that it would lead you into repentance. There's some of you who are followers of Jesus, and to be honest, you have been neglecting the conviction of the Holy Spirit for a long time now. And if you were to give an honest evaluation of your life, you would say that you look way more like the world than like your Heavenly Father. So my encouragement for you is to do the same. The beauty of the gospel is that you don't have to work to get out of this. The beauty of the gospel is that you set your mind on what's been done for you, and let that stir your heart's affections. Then you live in light of it, knowing that you've been forgiven, that you don't have to earn anything, because it was earned for you on the cross through Jesus' righteousness. And I hope and pray that you will repent and walk in pursuit of this holiness, and that you too would be different from the world, that you would rally around other followers of Jesus and be a light in the darkness. There's others of you who you might check the box Christian, but in reality your life looks nothing like your Heavenly Father. And here's the thing: you weren't set free to sin, you were set free from sin. And so if this is your mentality, that you were set free to sin, just to be completely honest, you really need to do a heart check and see if you really even know Jesus. Because if you knew Jesus, you would know that you've been set free from the powers of sin and death, and you would pursue this righteousness. And yes, you would stumble and you would fall, but your whole heart and mentality would change. And there's even some of you who you come in here and you're just checking it all out, and you aren't a follower of Jesus, and you know that, and we're glad you're here. But what you need to understand is that you too can walk in this newness of life, that you too can be born again and given this living hope and this rich inheritance. You can be given a life of thriving as a son or daughter of the King. That if you would just confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe that God raised him from the dead, and you would live in light of this hope of this gospel, that you too will be given new life. So however it is you need to respond, I just want to encourage you to do that, and to let the truth of God's word stir your heart's affections into worshiping him as we finish our service tonight singing praises. I pray that you'd be able to sing with all of your heart to him because of what's been done for you on the cross of Jesus. Lord, we thank you so much for just who you are. Lord, we thank you for your son, Jesus. Lord, we thank you for setting us free from sin, Lord. God, that you give us the strength and the ability through the power of the Holy Spirit to walk in newness of life, to walk in pursuit of holiness. God, I pray that we would have the gospel ever present on our minds and on our hearts, Lord. And God, that we would live as lights in this dark world. God, as the moon reflects the light of the sun, I pray that we would reflect the light of your Son, and that by your grace and through the power of the Holy Spirit, we would win some. Lord, we love you and we trust you. In your name I pray. Amen.
wrong to spend a lot of time in 1 Peter tonight and for us to know that our response to seeing Jesus as our living hope is to be holy, and for us to not sing the song Living Hope. And so I think a lot of you probably know it anyway. That's what I'm banking on. I really hope so. But we're going to sing this together and just really take encouragement in the confidence that we have that Jesus is our eternal hope. He's the inheritance that we will receive, not the thing that we hope for like we hope for other things. You know, like I hope Georgia wins a national championship this year, right? But we're Georgia fans, so we know. Like, it's a hope. But that's not the way that we hope in Jesus. We hope in Jesus because what Jesus says will happen, and our eternity is secure in it. So let's sing this song together.
Chasm that lay between us, how high the mountain.
good to us all the time. And it's by your goodness and your mercy that we've overcome. And so, Lord, we don't brag on ourselves.